I don't know if you've asked yourself why you are here. I mean, you know, kind of existentially, but of course you are in a Bauhaus, right? Because you're in a kind of confusion of a factory, a workshop, a party space, an eating space, a laboratory, all the things that Bauhaus aspired to. If the Bauhaus was floating in the fields outside Dessau, if you look at the building, it's a kind of a ship, right? And in a certain sense, every school is a kind of ship. You leave the world behind in order to travel into your mind and all of that. And here you are ridiculously floating on a kind of lake in the middle of Berlin. So you're in Berlin, but you're not in Berlin. So in many, many ways, and of course, you're already having a kind of a good time. You're young, interesting, whatever. You're not poor. By the way, you're not poor enough and you're not thin enough to be at the Bauhaus. You have to understand the students in that moment were really almost dying. And so there was a kind of a theatrics that comes out of actually not being alive or almost not alive that has a lot to do with what we're talking about. But of course, this idea of being in Bauhaus as a strange place outside Dessau or in this floating university outside, inside Berlin, this idea of being outside the norm is kind of ridiculous because the Bauhaus can never be outside the norm because Bauhaus has did so much, hence the hatred, to define what the norm is. The Bauhaus is absolutely everywhere, right? Just everywhere. In your objects, of course, in your pockets, in your brain, in your business, in your politics, most obviously in your phone, that smooth object in your pocket, which in theory enables you to connect with anyone, anytime, anywhere, to express yourself. And to what percentage of the time do you spend expressing yourself? But of course, it's not so much that you hold the cell phone as the networks hold you through the phone and they use the phone to extract money from you all the time. So in a certain sense, the cell phone is a perfect example of Bauhaus design. It's no accident. Steve Jobs goes to a conference on design at Aspen. The campus at Aspen is designed by Herbert Bayer after coming out of Bauhaus. And he hears a lecture on Bauhaus and declares himself at that moment that he will operate in a kind of a Bauhaus spirit. The whole principle of the of that object, the way it looks, the way it's shaped, is of course absolutely directly linked to Bauhaus, and the whole point of that object is to not be shocking, right? If you think of the avant-garde in the arts, so much we think of a discourse about shock, a reacting to the shock, the horror of the war, the horror of industrialization, and so much Bauhaus is the exact opposite. How to produce a sense of smoothness, a sense of calm in the face of industrialization, threats to subjectivity, and so on. It's so smooth, no bumps, no cracks, no deviations, especially no deviations, but many, many secrets, right? Actually, the whole point of the cell phone is that you don't know what's inside it and you don't want to know, and you don't want to know what you're really connected to. So part of the sort of dream world of the phone, the dream world of the Bauhaus, is these very, very smooth surfaces that keep secrets away from you. This is just to say the Bauhaus, and the Bauhaus object is a kind of mechanism of repression. For Beatrice and I, this is part of a kind of longer discourse, right, about good design. Bauhaus is very much the kind of model of good design, and we don't think that good design is good. Good design is part of a longer history, let's say at least from the 1830s through to the 1930s. The Bauhaus, in a certain way, put the finishing touches on the concept of good design. In other words, they designed design. They completed the design of design. Design itself is not a set of material properties. It's not a thing you do with your brain. It's an idea, right? It's a way of describing things. They kind of perfected that way. That's exactly why the Bauhaus has expanded itself outside, beyond objects, to interfaces, prosthetics, and to the body itself. The shape, the look, the behavior, the genetics. You can now reshape your genetics. You can adjust your genes, and you use attitudes and principles and concepts of beauty that were established there. This is why, as Beatrice was saying before, we think of the Bauhaus as a virus, but this is a virus with no kind of known cure. This is an astonishingly successful virus. Maybe one of the reasons you can't kill it is that it's already dead. This is a kind of a zombie movie, like when we got into this question of thinking about a funeral for the Bauhaus with Philip and Christian. I mean, I think the it's not so easy to kill because it's already dead, and then the question is like when did it die and so on. And I was tempted to argue that this happened in the Museum of Modern Art in 1939 when Gropius produces this kind of sanitized version of the Bauhaus. Philip was arguing yesterday persuasively that maybe the 1932 Deutsche Werkbund show in Paris, which was a kind of a closet Bauhaus exhibition, dominated by Gropius and Breuer, that already this was an already dead Bauhaus, and it is the dead Bauhaus that you have in your pocket. That is to say, it is the official Bauhaus, and so on. They produced a kind of cleaned up version of the Bauhaus. Actually, that was a piece of Bauhaus design. Like, how do you take the Bauhaus and produce an image of it that's smooth? Right, so a smooth image of a place that produces smoothness, you hide not only the secrets of the place, but the secrets of your own capacity to produce a smooth image. Right, so double zombie. And so, of course, this whole question, Beatrice and I, we come at it from two different directions. Beatrice comes at it from a kind of a longer research study of hers on the perversions, on the angle of perversions. What does it mean in terms of perversion? I think of it in terms of extreme design. In the end, we kind of end up at the same place from different points of view. My general argument is that Bauhaus is kind of a great example of a really radical, extreme performance. When people think of Bauhaus, they think, oh, yeah, performance, you know, like Schlemmer and weird costumes and all of that. There was nothing, really, really nothing weird about that. You have to understand to what extent Schlemmer and all those things around him are so institutionalized in our understanding of art that there's absolutely nothing radical, nothing extreme about those forms of behavior from a kind of contemporary perspective. Precisely, maybe the least performative aspect of the Bauhaus may have been the theater, the official theater, whether it be in the hands, let's say, of Schlemmer or later of Molinage and so on. Even the fact that there is a stage at the center of the building is, of course, important, but most of you could draw the Bauhaus, but maybe not identify where the stage is or what the nature of the stage is. In fact, there are very, very few images of the stage per se, sometimes of the performance. Most of the images are of the building itself. So actually, the real performance was to be a Bauhaus student, to be a Bauhaus teacher. The building itself was a stage set for performance. So in the context of the seminar with the students, who were amazing, continue to be amazing, it was all about trying to understand the parties. If you can find an image of a Bauhaus student actually enjoying one of those parties, good for you, right? You can eat for free. They hated it. They hated it. It was a real job. Annoying teachers who make you prepare for parties like today, think about it. We have reproduced the phenomenon precisely. Annoying teachers that say that you have to have a great time and make a great time, and you work and work and work and work, and the students will confirm to you it was a lot of work to produce this show that you might enjoy, but they won't enjoy because they're dead physically, financially, etc. And they hate each other also because they've had to produce this thing. So this idea of the official party, you will now enjoy yourself between 3 and 6, this kind of logic, is a performance, but it's a performance of happiness, but it's not a happy performance. Teachers likewise had to act the part of a performer, of a teacher. That of course meant being acting the part of being a man, not an easy thing to do, by the way, tricky, weird thing to do. It meant, for example, no woman teachers, or at least if you become a woman teacher, then pretend to be a man. Likewise, the students, yes, of course, we wouldn't have a division between male and female in a liberated, free-thinking, experimental society, as long as it is that the woman looked like men, not like the men looking like the woman. In other words, everything must lean in a certain direction, and ultimately, the enslavement of the woman who are working in the sweatshops to produce the material, which is producing the money for the... So they're actually a very strictly gender-organized institution, glamorizing a kind of androgynous image. A smooth image, a smoothing out of the difference between genders, is a successful mechanism for repressing the fact that actually the operation of that institution was entirely efficiently subordinating the woman within. And here we just speak in the loosest possible terms about genders, and of course we would multiply through sexual identities of multiple kinds and transitory kinds and so on. The pedagogy itself as a kind of performative act if you really think there was a Bauhaus curriculum, you think it because you think of a certain kind of drawing, but did that drawing actually map onto what was actually going on? By the way, that drawing reproduced in almost every design school in the world. There's a little Bauhaus in every kind of educational system, but no evidence that actually follows the theory. It's in the media, of course, not by accident, the Bauhaus. These are the experts in modern publicity techniques. Right, very, very little you will encounter in advertising is not set up by the graphic design procedures that were monumentalized at that place. Of course, it's in the objects in themselves and in the concept of domesticity. I'm just going, kind of rehearsing the various themes that the students were exploring in the class. Ultimately, it leads to the thought that the Bauhaus was a kind of performance space in which there was a very, very radical performance being done to produce a certain concept of smoothness in the face of industrialization and globalization to some extent, and also a kind of highly efficient broadcast studio to kind of circulate this image. Mainly, I would suggest, students were the victims of this then victimizing system, which is now used by politicians and everyone. Of course, as with most modern designers and architects and so on, there is a kind of ambition to design a new human. And this is clearly stated by Gropius and everybody else, and it is, of course, the very epicenter of the thinking of people like Schlemmer. What I think is so important to understand, is they didn't just have the idea of a new human, that they accomplished, this was accomplished. There was the production of a kind of modern subject efficiently in a relationship with certain kind of objects and certain kind of financial terms, certain understanding of what constitutes that. There was an absolutely successful form of human engineering carried out by that group. That's the sign, it's over. I hand you over to Beatrice. Enough.
Okay, so of course, as you know, we say that you can go and have your hair cut or do all these other things, but if you want to hear a little bit of what I have to say, it really goes back to what we're saying at the beginning, that it's not that the Bauhaus was weird or that these architects were weird, it's that the whole of modern architecture, you can argue, that is weird, and that we work very, very hard to repress this fact, right? Furthermore, perhaps the hypothesis to give it to you at the beginning is that the perversions of modern architecture are not an anomaly, but are the very engine of modern architecture. So instead of talking about the Bauhaus that the students have done so well and will perform now for you in different ways, I will talk about the perversions of modern architecture. In general, architecture, as I said before, it has always been understood as having a normalizing function, right? Establishing patterns that are stable, predictable, and to some extent standardized. This idea of architecture is intimately associated with the idea of the normals, but perhaps it's even the caretaker, architecture, the caretaker of the normal, but the normal is not normal at all. It's a kind of artifact, always produced, never found. It's a construction actually involving a certain kind of violence too. And meanwhile, there is a whole tradition in architecture of the transgressive. You have something in the screen, perhaps illustrating some of these architects, which is work that crosses the lines of the normal, complicating these lines, threatening the limit. So here we go with the perversions of modern architecture, which I say is never ever straightforward. And of course, perversions comes from the Latin pervertere, which means to turn away, that is to turn away from normality. And there is a relationship actually between the personal, often extreme, pathologies of modern architecture and their call for a new normal, a concept between which the new concept of the human that Mark talks about actually emerges. But the way I have organized this talk is by looking at different perversions, just to give you a sense of some case studies that you could talk about. But in fact, it's never like this, because each architect has multiple perversions. In fact, I started to wonder whether to have multiple perversions was a requirement to be an influential architect. Think, for example, about Le Corbusier. here as an odalisque, dressed as an odalisque, with his friend Kleinstein when they were in the trip to the Orient. He's presumably the most influential architect of the 20th century, but as you probably know, he was deeply into the occult, into esoteric philosophies, sexual complexities. Here are some drawings of the 1917, particularly obsessed with sex between women, particularly black women and white women, again cross-dressing as a housekeeper, totally into the scatological, paper tower, the toilet, etc., with disease, with nudismo, with the bidet, bodybuilding, the animal. This is actually PP. He's obsessed with children peeing. This is the maternal of Le Corbusier, and he has all these pictures in his books of children peeing. I mean, you may want to wonder why we don't think about these questions, right? With nudismo, with bodybuilding, of course, with the animal. This is his dog. He adored his dog, but when the dog died, he with the fark, he covered his book Don Quixote, and he also made a rug with the dog. And he's also, of course, obsessed with the other, particularly with the Algerian women, which he drew eternally, and also the collection of postcards that he acquired while he was in Algiers. Likewise, if you take a much less known figure like Carlo Molino, whose architecture and design are literally the product of perversion, so much so that he's not easily placed in a traditional account of modern architecture. They don't know, historians don't know where to position this Molino, who was, of course, into the occult, and a car racer at Le Mans. He not only designed the car, but won several times. He was also a extreme skier. He designed these skis that facilitate skiing much faster, and I'm not so sure what he's doing right now, but of course, you know that the guy is not exactly normal, right? So you have these two extremes. On the one hand, Le Corbusier, a seemingly straight architect who is secretly twisted, and Molino, a seemingly twisted architect who is secretly at the center of architecture. So the question for me is whether the so-called perversions are really twists of modern architecture, or are in fact this a very engine. And as I say, I will present this as a form of case studies, starting with bodybuilding. That's bodybuilding and extreme exercise and the erotics of exercise. Because as you know, modern architecture presents itself as lean and fit, and all the excess weight of neoclassical tradition strip off to reveal a muscular and agile body in a sports outfit. And I'm not making this up. This is an illustration from Gideon. Gideon uses this next to a building of modern architecture. So you have this image of modern architecture as being also strong and healthy. And think also about all the bodybuilding houses in modern architecture, from Marcel Breuer's Room for Piscator here in Berlin. The idea is that all the houses of modern architecture has this exercise equipment, and that modern architecture implies this idea of the body, of the bodybuilder, as you can see in so many examples, from Marcel Breuer to Richard Docker to the house in wherever it is, in Rotterdam, to Gropius, to the swimming pool of Maleta Stevens in years, and even at a popular level, how when the Tugendhat House, for example, was abandoned during the German occupation of Czechoslovakia, it was immediately turned by, and then eventually taken over by the communist bureaucrats, who have no idea what to do with the house, and they say, oh yeah, this is perfect for a gym for handicapped children. So here you have the early photographs of the little Tugendhat kids playing naked in the terrace, which is uncanny reflected in the image of children with disabilities exercising in the living room, turned into a gym. or this dance kids in the terrace. This is the terrace outside the Tugendhat. Even the architect feels that he has to give examples. So you have Ducker here, and this is his famous open air school, and here he's jumping in the water to demonstrate that it's not exactly your heroic figure of the architect in front of a building, but he's jumping into this pond because the architect himself has to give example of new ethics. If you move to the late 20th century, it's not by chance that Greg Kurhaus chooses the Downtown Athletic Club as the core of his retroactive manifesto of Manhattan in Delirious New York, and here with these boxers eating oysters. But even less known is this Casa Palestra, the bodybuilding house, which he developed as part of the Biennale Triennale of 1986. And he basically takes the Barcelona pavilion and bends it so that it fits into the place that was given to them in the Triennale. And it's, of course, an homage to the Barcelona pavilion and, by extension, to modern architecture that at that time was in the height of postmodernism, was under attack as being lifeless, empty, and puritanical. And he writes that it's been our conviction that modern architecture is actually an hedonistic movement that is abstraction, rigor, and severity, and in fact plots to create the most provocative settings for the experiment that is modern life. And so here you have this newly curved Barcelona pavilion inhabited by gymnasts, bodybuilders, and exercise equipment. The famous sculpture of Kolbe at the end of the basin is now being replaced with an image of this bodybuilder. It took me a long time to realize that this actually was Lisa Lyon. It's a woman, actually the first bodybuilding champion in Los Angeles. Kurhaus, who wrote, as you know, a script for an erotically charged film, The White Slave, before becoming an architect, turns architecture here into a movie set. These are all stills from a movie that he did in this pavilion for an expanding, eroticized body. I'm not so sure exactly what is going on here, but you can see the same thing I see. So we move on to another case study, which could be sex, health, and nudism. Sorry, I'm going so fast, but just to give you kind of a panorama of the place in which I see the Bauhaus operating. Of course, Sindre and Neutra are all very well known to you in the history of modern architecture for their respective health houses. For Dr. Lowell in California, Sindler did the Lowell Beach House in Newport between 1922 and 26, and Neutra did the Lowell townhouse in Los Angeles in 1927. But less well known is that the impulse behind both houses came less from a straight modern architecture theories than from sex, health, psychoanalysis, and nudism theories. Modern architecture was here inseparable from a new lifestyle, which include vegetarian diet, exercise, sunbathing in the nude, sleeping in the open air, and dressing in simple robes made from natural fibers. This is actually Schindler, who went camping in some park in the Yosemite, I think, in the United States. And there is where he has this revelation about what architecture should be. And he says he influenced his Schindler Chase house in Los Angeles. And here is Pauline. And as I say, Pauline, you know, also embraced this theory of living a simple life. And here is with the wife of Lowell, where they ran this kindergarten that was, in fact, very, very much inspired by the ideas of the Lebens Reform that you know very well in Germany, which, as you know, advocated back to nature, lifestyle of fresh air, gardening, health food, alternative medicine, nudism, sexual liberation, and avoidance of alcohol, tobacco, vaccines, etc. And these ideas, by the way, had arrived in California, where many of these proponents of the movement actually emigrated. Even actually Neutra contribute to this magazine on the recommendation of his secretary. This is, of course, before the Me Too movement, but here you have Nude Living and Richard Neutra, and in the article they say that it was his secretary, Audrey, that you see here, able and agile, and Neutra's nudist secretary that has recommended that Neutra will write in this magazine about nudism. Lowell, actually, which is the client of these both houses, was not really a doctor. He never studied medicine. He was more a quack, if you want. He did a 2-week course on chiropractor and then went to California, where he became widely successful instantly, advocating all kinds of theories about health life. He opened this physical cultural center where he offered all these treatments, and he also ran a column in the LA Times called Care of the Body, where at a certain point he published also The House of Neutra, given even directions of how to visit the house. The whole house was organized around his full regime of sun, air, exercise, fasting, and diet strategies. He became the House of Neutra became like a demonstration of Dr. Lowell's theories. They have sleeping rooms outside every bedroom so you can prevent tuberculosis and all these things. But listen to this. They have also hydrotherapy equipment and marathon showers in the master bedroom, which was also equipped with a built-in enema fixture with various douches and nozzles device thermostatically controlled. So, you know, it's a whole kind of, as I say, and here you have the publication, and you can see in the publication that is the publication of the house next to advertisements for pelvic troubles, men and women, or rupture, or severe cases of constipation, and I don't know what else. And all of this, of course, speaks about the very much preoccupation of Americans at that point, middle class Americans, with the functioning of their body physically and also aesthetically. Neutra, most interesting, here he is, given the tour of the house, thought that his building could not just improve the health of the inhabitants, but also their sex life. And this is super interesting. Many of the clients of Neutra apparently talked to him about their nervous problems, their marital problems, their fertility problems. And in fact, his theory of architecture, according to Neutra himself, was a theory of the nerves, right? The interaction precisely between body and brain, and he thought that the architect was kind of a shrink, right? And here he is talking with a client. A symptomatic figure in all of this is Wilhelm Reich. Wilhelm Reich was a protege of Freud, who deviated from his theories and was expelled from psychoanalytical circles and settled in America in 1939. He was the inventor of this box, the Orgone Energy Accumulator, popularized as the orgasm machine in films like Woody Allen, what is called Sleeper, or Roger Badan, Barbadella. This is the amazing thing. Many clients of Neutra have such a thing in their apartment. Actually, Neutra apparently was recommended that you will have this Orgone machine, which was supposed to be for everything, for your arthritis, for preventing cancer. I don't know what. The only thing that was demonstrated, and everybody agreed with that, is that it will improve your sex life. And so that was very important. Reich himself thought that the libido was affected by physical space, and of course, Neutra subscribed to this idea. But then the interesting twist is when he thinks himself that the house itself, actually his houses, are accumulators. That is, they improve the sexual performance of the client. Several clients of Neutra, like these guys, Josephine and Robert Choi, commissioned a house for him that became a salon for orgone users, but also for early experiments with LSD. So you have also the question of drugs and modern architecture. Okay, very quickly, eating disorders. You think modern architecture has nothing to do with eating disorders? It has a lot to do with eating disorders. Many modern architects had eating disorders, but for me, the most interesting one is perhaps Kiesler and other emigres from Vienna. They are all coming from Vienna, which also thought that the house was supposed to satisfy the psyche of the dweller. Actually, the house was a human body, according to him, a living organism with organs, the stairs, the feet, the ventilation. system is the nose, and so on. And a nervous system, he says, and a digestive system that very importantly can suffer from constipation, upset with constipation, all of them. So, for Kiesler, modern architecture was full of repressions that needed to be unblocked in the name of pleasure. And that's when he starts designing his endless house, which is like a stomach. As you can see, full of folds, absorbing juices and nutrients. And the interesting thing is when he describes, and again, I got stuck here again. He describes modern architecture as architecture on a diet. And this is how he describes architecture on a diet. This is the aftermath of World War II. This is retroactively. He's talking about modern architecture to a journalist, and he says, we had nothing to eat. He's talking about the end and how hungry, World War I, and how hungry they were. We had nothing to eat. I recall very well my own situation after the war. I lived on the dole for many years, and I was living only with $7 a month, but one could live on monastically. I had rich chifli and mushrooms. I remember only well, too well, the mushrooms, which I dried and reheated again and again, as I did with the tea leaf. So it's constantly doing the same thing. And it's, you know, our livid habit, we started to clean everything that was surplus in design ornamentation, certain luxurious materials, moldings, this and that. Everything became over the years simpler, cleaner, whiter. And you know what we call a functionalism was on its natural way. So functionalism, he says, was really a reaction to the overstuffing of the Victorian age. Architecture, he says, has to be put on a diet, and the rectangular style did it. And so that's how he explains modern architecture. Modern architecture as cleaning up all the excess of the Victorian age at the time in which actually they were hungry, right? They were not eating anything. Here you have Kiesler, who symptomatically always photographs himself inside his own structure. So the house is kind of a cocoon, a protector for this very fragile body. But leave along Kiesler, and let's move to fetishism. And for fetishism, I take another Viennese. I mean, this Viennese never stopped giving. This is Bernard Rudowski, who opened an exhibition at MoMA in 1944, which in many ways are clothes modern, which in many ways you can say is an attack on the former and better known exhibition of modern architecture, the famous International Style exhibition at MoMA in 1931, who, according to Bernard Rudowski, repressed everything that was interesting in modern architecture and design, and what is what this everything that it repressed and that was most interesting to him, the primitive, the psychological, sensuality, and the erotic. So these are things that that Bernard Rudowski thought they were part of modern architecture, and the exhibition International Style had cleaned up all this complexity, have cleaned up all this most interesting aspect. The exhibition challenged orthodox thinking about modernity by looking at the distorted bodies of that correspond to the personal torture devices, he said, that are part of everyday clothing, and develops this catalogue of the abnormal bodies that are lurking between presumably normal clothing. So, for example, he has this tennis outfit of 1886, and then makes a drawing of the body implied by this outfit. And then the literal torture binding of the feet of young Chinese girls, he claimed was actually acted out daily on the streets of the West. So there is not much difference for him between the torture of the Chinese girls and the regular comfortable shoe that is always stylish. But it's not only women. He was also very critical of this Oxford shoe, and he kept saying he made this arrangement, and he argued that if we keep going that way with this kind of Western shoe, we will end up developing a big toe in the middle. For Rudowski, the sign was literally redesigning the body. He talks about sartoriadis, or the enjoyment of discomfort. So he talks really about this masochistic pleasure that in the West we derive from clothing. He ended up designing some kind of counterfashion. You can see he's really a fetish, food fetishes. This including these Bernardo sandals that are still in production, that were very popular in the 60s. Jackie Kennedy is supposed to have owned 16 pairs of such sandals. Okay, so let's move to bondage. So as you see, we are getting stronger and stronger as we move along. We go from exercise, so now we are in bondage. Here is Bernard Tschumi, who in 1976-77 produced this series of polemical advertisements for architecture, which is a kind of visual manifesto, a kind of parody of commercial advertisement. And each advertisement is a striking, sometimes shocking image accompanied by a slogan. For example, you have this image of somebody thrown out of a high window that goes with the slogan, "To really appreciate architecture, you may even need to commit murder." And in another one, the bondage one, you have this image of a semi-nude person completely tied with thick, intricate, knotted ropes. And the text suggests that architecture is a form of pleasure or bondage through the constraints of self-imposed rules. In fact, he writes, "The game of architecture is an intricate play with rules that you may break or accept. These rules, like so many knots that cannot be untied, have the erotic significance of bondage. The more numerous and sophisticated the restraints, the greater the pleasure." I introduce you to the former dean of the school of, then the future dean, because it's in the 70s, but in the 80s he became the dean of the School of Architecture at Columbia University. I find fascinating this work of Bernard. In another advertisement, he shows this Villa Savoy in a complete state of disrepair. And he says, "Sensuality has been known to overcome even the most rational of buildings. Architecture is the ultimate erotic art, carried to excess, and will reveal both the traces of reason and the sensuous experience of space simultaneously." The advertisements of Bernard Tschumi coincide with a set of interrelated essays on the relationship between architecture and transgression, eroticism, violence, pleasure, and limits. He was deeply, of course, influenced by Georges Bataille. And here you have some of the images. The titles of these articles of Bernard of these years are "Architecture and Transgression," 1975, "The Pleasure of Architecture," "Architecture and Its Limits," "Violence and Architecture," etc., etc. So you can see the influence of Bataille clearly. This is what he writes. "Any relationship between a building and its user is one of violence. For any use means the intrusion of a human body into a given space, the intrusion of one order into another. The love of violence, after all, is an ancient pleasure. Why has architectural theory regularly refused to acknowledge such pleasures and always claim, at least officially, that architecture should be pleasing to the eyes as well as comfortable to the body?" So here you have it. "The pleasure of violence," he finished this test, "can be experienced in every other human activity. So why is architecture denying that there is pleasure in violence?" Voyeurism. This is a case study that I know very well, so I will give a very brief thing because it's endless for me. When Le Corbusier in 1949 built this very small cabanon right for himself in the beach at Cap Martin, right behind the house of Eileen Gray, with you may know what he was completely obsessed with her for many reasons, probably including the fact that she was a lesbian architect and therefore outside his control. He had built Eileen Gray this beautiful house in Cap Martin for her and for Badovici, with whom he had a very short and often misunderstood relationship, but he built the cabanon right behind, so that it becomes a kind of Eileen Gray called it a dog's watchdog house or something. But he's overlooking the house, and here you have in the cabin drawing House of Eileen Gray, drawing this mural. Because this is the thing, before he drew he did his Kavanaugh. He used to borrow the house of Eileen Gray. They were friends with Badovici and with Eileen Gray. And he will borrow the house, and one Easter, he goes there for a couple of weeks, and he drew 8 murals without asking permission to anybody in the white walls of the house of Eileen Gray. And of course, Eileen Gray was furious. And here he is on some pictures that I found in a Fundación Le Corbusier, where he is in the process of doing these murals in the house of Eileen Gray, like almost like peeing in the walls, like leaving his mark. And he then claimed later, when she was upset, that the murals had made the house more beautiful. And she's like, I mean, imagine that somebody will do the same to his Villa Savoie or something like that, no? But he was all like, okay, here I am. And the murals, the interesting thing is that they all go back to his obsession with the women of Algiers, where he had been in 1931. And have photographed many Algerian women semi-nude and nude, and make extensive drawings and acquire an extraordinary collection of postcards of these women. And you see the postcard on the left and the drawing of Le Corbusier on the right, and it's clearly what is happening, so I don't have to explain, because you see the same thing I see. This became more and more abstract, and eventually became part of this mural that he will do, these murals that he will do in Cap Martin, including this one called Graffiti at Cap Martin, where he says that Eileen Gray is the figure on the left and Badovici the figure on the right, and that the little figure in the middle is their desired child that was never born. Now, you know, Eileen Gray had this short relationship with Badovici, but clearly he was openly lesbian, so this is an act of violence to say that this is their desired child. Anyway, I move on to the question of porn, or private porn, or something like this, with the figure of Molino. Which, as I said before, nobody knows what to make of him. He's an architect, an interior designer, furniture maker, engineer, photographer, fashion designer, set designer, car designer. He also raced at Le Mans. As I say here, you have him racing at Le Mans and winning several times at Le Mans. He was also a stunt pilot and champion skier, who not only designed these skis, but even wrote a book about how to descend rapidly. And he was also a professor of architecture and many other things. Marginalizing architecture, history, and these are all objectives that I have collected for the multiple publications, as enigmatic, nonconformist, elusive, individualist, lone wolf, troublesome, a unique case, marginal, special, eccentric, turbulent, holy madman, prima donna, diabolic, occult worshipper, and conventional at all costs, dissolute, erotomanic, kinky, and dangerous. So not a lot has been written in architecture about Molino, but every time there is somebody writing, those are the kinds of things that they say. What a collection of things. So in fact, Molino can never be pinned down, and there is kind of this irreducible sense of the illicit. In 1936, he built a house for himself, the apartment called Casa Miller in Torino, but he actually never lived there. The space was designed to house his fantasies. He used to photograph women, friends and clients, so it was a stage set for erotic fantasies. Those may look to you like the diagrams of rational movement, but they are not at all. They are the angles at which the photograph is going to be taken, and he photographed, as I say, friends, women, friends and clients. But all of a sudden, and these are the pictures from this house, Hans Miller, and all of a sudden, in the 60s, he becomes much more obscure. He does a secret apartment. Nobody knows, not even his closest friends know that he has it. And he also builds this, or somehow arranges this Casa Molino. And this is the difference. Before were women that he knew, and now they are women that he doesn't know. He'd never seen them before, and he will never see them again. Invite them to this house, And this is how he will do it. He will cruise the streets and the clubs of Turin and identify women to his driver, that then with the excuse that this was a very important man, I could not be seen, soliciting in the street, were offered a huge amount of money to come to this apartment, to this house, where they thought they were going to have sex, but no sex was ever happened. They will be dressed and undressed in all these outfits that Molino had designed, all acquired, these shoes and these belts and these underwear, and there will be all this collection of Polaroid images, this album of thousands of Polaroid images, a secret album, and the fantasy of Molino is that this woman will accompany him in his afterlife. Okay, so the whole apartment, according to him, was designed like a tomb with all the paraphernalia for a safe passage to the afterlife. He slept in a bed that was like a boat to cross the last river. You don't see the boat, but you see the butterflies, that of course the icon of reincarnation, and you see the floor that is blue, so he was supposed to fly away or sail away with all these women. Okay. Eschatology. The entire history of modern architecture could also be explained or could be written from the point of view of the toilet. This is an obsession for almost all architects. The bidets, the toilets, from Adolf Loos and his poetry of the American plumbing. You see here his obsession with toilet paper, for example, or masturbation for that matter. To Le Corbusier, the icon of the bidet, and he also left the bidet in the middle of the living space in his own apartment, embarrassing his wife, that always, when they have visitors, cover the bidet with a tea towel, right, to hide it away. Or Paul Rudolph's townhouse in Manhattan, where from the entrance lobby you could look up and view through the glass bottom of the glass tub. Modern architecture always challenged traditional morality. Adolf Loos, as I say, is full of his writings are full of eschatological reference. He compares America to Austria, and the significance of America is the use of toilet paper. That's the biggest difference. And Austria is the use of toilet paper. And in response, he says that the most interesting works of art that America has created are the plumbing and the bridges. So this is before, of course, Marcel Duchamp, anticipates Marcel Duchamp by several years. Le Corbusier not only left, as I said, the bidet in the middle of his space, but in the cabanon, he also left the toilet open. Another obsession with, and in, of course, as you go into Villa Savoie, the most important thing, as you see, is the sink and then the bathtub that is left open into the room, etc., etc. Another architect obsessed with the toilet, and Mark has talked much more than me about this, is Buckminster Fuller, who not only designed this Diamaxion bathroom, but he, you can see that he even photographs his own naked body, the body of Bucky Fuller, in his own bathroom. Eventually, for him, all houses were spaceships, and spaceships were houses, as you may know. He thought that we had been, as human beings, radio from another planet into this one, and that one day we will go back to where we were radio from. So toilet and telepathy, in his case, are inseparable. And of course, in the meantime, Le Corbusier goes more and more into the toilet. This is an incredible number of sketches about the different kinds of techniques of bathrooms and, well, anyway. So last one, pederastia. So yeah, we go into the heavy duty now. You know very well the architect Adolf Loos. What you probably don't know is when Adolf Loos arrived in Paris in 1926, it's not that he said, okay, I'm tired of Austria now and I would like to live in Paris. He was actually in the run, accused of pedophilia, accused of pederastia in Vienna, a fact that is carefully concealed until written scholarship on Loos. The whole saga started when here is, of course, his Ornament and Crime, but of course his moralistic Ornament and Crime is actually written by a criminal, as you will see in a minute. This is the room for his wife and the house for Josephine Baker. But let me go into the pederastia directly, which is 904, his most important commission. Villa Karma in the shores of the Lake Geneva is commissioned by this Dr. Theodore Baer, who you see here, a psychiatrist and photographer and author. But the construction of the villa was interrupted when the owner, this professor of the University of Vienna, and now a very close friend of Loos, was accused of pederastia and fled to Switzerland and then to England and the United States to avoid preventive prison before the trial. Baer enlisted his friends Loos, and Loos enlisted his friend Karl Kraus to support him and defend him, which we all did in the pages of Die Fackel. Lina Loos, also Altenberg. Lina Loos, the first wife of Loos, who had stayed in Villa Karma, must have seen something because he refused to support Dr. Baer and took a strong issue with Adolf Loos about it, so much so that Lina eventually separated from Loos soon after this event. And by the way, he became highly regarded writer in newspapers focusing on questions of social justice and the rights of women. Baer came back to Vienna in 1905 for his trial, and he was convicted at the trial and sentenced to 3 months of prison and was stripped of his title at the university. He avoided prison by paying the bail, but his wife committed suicide a few months later. Remarkably, and this is the story where Loos goes, apparently Baer, before leaving to Switzerland, etc., gave Loos 2 iron boxes full of incriminating evidence, photographs of children. Erotic photographs of children to safeguard. And in a remarkable gesture, Loos renovated his entire apartment, his entire chimney, to accommodate these boxes. So here you have, before these boxes arrive, how is the chimney, who has this bench made with brick where he and Lisa used to sit down, and then all of a sudden he renovated to accommodate these 2 boxes that you see here on both sides of the chimney. It appears, if you look closely, in all the photographs of the apartments published many years. In fact, the only photograph of Loos that we know in his apartment, he is showing him in front of the chimney with the secret boxes behind him as if he was guarding them. When Loos himself was accused of pederastia and arrested on September 5th, 1926, the police found 2 incriminating boxes in his apartment. Apparently he had gone to the Prater, he used to go to the Prater and pick up little keys that he would bring to his apartment, and with the excuse that he was making new drawings, he would force them to take a bath and I don't know what, and they kind of complained to their mothers, one of them complained, and the whole thing was unveiled. So when the police came to his apartment, they discovered the 2 boxes, and when Loos tried to defend himself, he say, in fact, he raised more questions than answers. He says, the photos that have been found in my house and that the police want to connect to my affair had been sent to me by a writer who is now dead and who didn't want that they will be found among his heritage. I have to immediately clarify that the writer is not Peter Altenberg. Who has asked him about Peter Altenberg? You will know immediately, right? I don't have anything to do with this heritage. If I was really a collector of photos of this genre, I would have added some in the last 15 years. Maybe it was an error on my part not to have burned that package, not to have burned these 2 iron boxes full of. So it's very interesting that Loos feels the need to clarify that the owner of the photographs was not his late friend Peter Altenberg, who years before actually he had also been accused of pedophilia. Anyway, by the time Loos was arrested, he had probably, you can see here, all of a sudden this photographs that I always thought they were so cute of the lost houses, always with little kids, and I start thinking, okay, maybe this is not so cute anymore. But if you look at the photographs of his wife, it's very interesting because you think, oh, those are his wives when they were children. No, no, those are his wives when they were his wife. So he had a succession of childlike wives and other affairs. The moment they got a little bit old, past 18, you know, he got tired of them and got a new one. And he shared this interest with his friend Peter Altenberg. Actually, this one is dedicated to Peter Altenberg, which was, as I say, also suspected and arrested for child molestation. And they used the term kindmädchen, child girl, to describe the women that they were attracted to. This is the magazine Kunz, where Le Corbusier, with Loos published his supplement Das Andere, that you probably know. And this is the kind of articles you find there. But perhaps the most interesting testimony is from his ex-wife, Elsie Alman Loos, who you see here in this picture, also very much like a little girl. And he wrote later, when he had separated from him, "I have always been a woman child, and this is what Loos love in me. But all of a sudden, he finds that I don't have sex appeal. I mean, by Mexico, too old. And moreover, that my legs are too short. So if I had longer legs, he said, it would change my life. So Loos decided to take me to a surgeon he was a dancer. This girl was a dancer, this woman was a dancer, that will break my two legs and elongate them." So of course he decided not to break her legs and abandon him. And here you have, when she writes her memoirs, in that he doesn't look as a child anymore. So you can understand then the Loos public denunciation of public moralism denouncing ornament as a sign of savage perversion is perhaps a pathological symptom of what it attacks, a disguise, if you want, a displacement. So in a way, we could continue on and on. This is like a preliminary scan of the history of modern architecture. The central thesis, as I say, is that these perversions are not aberrations of modern architecture, but are its very engine, and that in many ways, what we have done with the Bauhaus fits into this longer and more complex history that we could have of what modern architecture is and has been. Okay, thank you.